Today's favorite Bible character is Jonah. And the reason why Jonah is my favorite Bible character today is because he is so very much like us. And sometimes it's easy to read or hear about these people that are in the Bible and their stories and what they have learned or gone through. And it's easy to think of them as being, you know, far away or, well, they lived in different times, so they don't really understand. And we tend to forget that they are a lot like us. And the reason why Jonah stands out to me this week, and I wanted to share his story with you, is because there are so many times when somebody does something to us in our life. Maybe they hurt our feelings by some mean words that they have said, or maybe they call us a name and we think about that all day and it bothers us and it starts to just really hurt inside. Or sometimes maybe people do something that really actually hurts our body. And, you know, maybe they threw something at us when they were angry, or, you know, we just hang out together as a family and maybe we start to fight. And it's easy to begin to think about that person. And, you know, we picture their face in our minds and we think they are mean or that person is terrible. And we miss out on seeing their heart, on seeing them the way God sees them. Instead, their face becomes the face that we picture when we think of meanness, and it sticks with us. And then we just start to think of that person as mean, and we miss out on the good things about them. And so I thought of that this week, and I thought of Jonah, because Jonah's story, sometimes we hear about Jonah, and we hear about his story of being swallowed by a whale, or a big fish, some people say. The Bible actually just says it was a big fish, and he gets swallowed by it in the middle of a storm, and he's in the belly of this fish for 3 days. And sometimes that's all we think of when we hear about Jonah's story. But there's something else about Jonah. So in case you haven't heard his story, let me go through his story a little bit. We are actually going to focus on Jonah chapter 4. So Jonah is a book in the Bible about the man named Jonah. And then his story is so long that they group it into chunks and they put a giant number next to it to help you know which chunk you're in. And those chunks are called chapters. So Jonah chapter 4, and it's going to be the whole chapter 4 that we're going to talk about today, that we're going to focus on. But let me kind of tell you a little bit about his story all the way before that in the whole book of Jonah. So Jonah is this man. And he is a prophet, and he goes around and he will speak God's words to the people. And so people begin to think of him as being very special and important, and he kind of likes that. And well, the Bible doesn't say that, but I imagine that. So he's going around and he speaks God's words to the people. That's basically what he does. Well, God at one point says, I want you to go speak my message to the people of Nineveh. And Jonah does not want to do this. See, Nineveh was a city far, far away, and it was a city that was for a whole nation of people that others looked at them and saw them as being very mean. They would try to take over people's homes. They wanted to live there instead. They would hurt people like bullies would. They were not a nice group of people. They were very wicked in what they would do. And so Jonah, he is a Hebrew or a Jew from Israel, and he doesn't want to go to them because they're a mean group of people. He sees their face as being a face of meanness. And so he doesn't want to go. And so what he does is he gets a ticket and jumps into a ship to be able to travel. If Nineveh's over here, he wants to travel all the way over here. He doesn't want to go to Nineveh. He goes the other direction to get away from it. He doesn't want to tell God's words to the people of Nineveh. Well, while he's on this ship, a huge storm comes up, and Jonah is asleep during this storm. But meanwhile, this giant, huge storm is going on to the point where all the sailors on the ship are scared and they're terrified. They're like, we have to figure out, because we each worship a different kind of God, and we know that some God is really angry right now, so we need to figure out what's going on. So the captain of the ship wakes up Jonah, and he wakes him up and he says, how can you sleep at a time like this? We're all going to die. We need to figure out what's going on. Well, Jonah had told them that he was running away from his God. And so they're all like, what did you do to make your God so angry? Because they cast lots, which was a way that they used in their minds to try to figure out what God might be saying. And so they realized that, oop, Jonah is the one that has a problem with God, that he's the one that God is angry with. So they said, what did you do? And so he's like, well, my God told me to go do something and I didn't want to do it. So I'm actually running away from him. And so what they do is they decide with Jonah, they're all talking, and they decide that Jonah has to be thrown overboard. Jonah has to be punished. It's the only way that would make God angry and make the storm stop. Now, this is their thinking. This is what's in their heads. And so they decide to do this. Well, the sailors, before they throw Jonah over the ship, they pray to God and they say, God, please don't punish us for throwing this man overboard. We're only doing what we think we should be doing. I changed the words a little bit. So that is their prayer. And so they throw Jonah overboard, and an amazing thing happens. As soon as he lands in the water, the storm stops and the ocean gets calm. Now, normally it takes some time for, the waves to kind of slow down a little bit, but that's not what happened. Jonah landed in the water and the storm, and it's just calm. And it's just a nice ocean now. And so the sailors know, wow, this was a God thing. And they worship God because of this. And that's amazing to me. But meanwhile, Jonah's in the ocean. And everyone thinks that, you get tossed over into the ocean and you have nothing to help you. You're going to sink, you're going to drown, and you're going to die. That's what everybody assumes. But God, who's a loving God, he sends a great big fish. And this great big fish, which some people picture in their heads as a whale, but we're not really for sure what it is, just a giant big fish, actually swallows Jonah. And Jonah is alive in this big fish in his belly for 3 days and 3 nights. And so he's alive. And while he's alive in there, I don't know about you, but I'd be pretty scared. And because Jonah's pretty scared, but he has a whole lot of time on his hands, because you know what? This big fish doesn't have some kind of craft room or a game closet where he can go and he can play games or watch video games while he's waiting for this fish, to let him out. This doesn't happen. So Jonah has a lot of time on his hands to think, and he uses this time to pray. And we see Jonah's prayer in the book of Jonah, and you're welcome to read it. But basically, he talks about how great God is and how wonderful God is and how important it is to be able to sacrifice, not meaning like some ideas of sacrifice that are in the Bible, but what Jonah is meaning is that he's not going to do what he wants. He's instead going to put that aside and do what God wants. Because he says, salvation comes from the Lord. So he knows that God is a God who saves out of his holy love. And so if God wants me to go and save this group of people, Nineveh, then I'm going to go. And that's what he decides. And when the Lord knows what is going on in Jonah's heart, and he knows that Jonah has gotten to this point of being willing to do what God has said to help a group of people, God commands the big fish, and the big fish actually spews or throws up Jonah, and Jonah comes out of the great big fish, and he's now on land. So then what Jonah decides to do is God says to him a second time, go and give my message to the people of Nineveh. And this time, because Jonah's heart was changed, Jonah does that. Jonah goes to Nineveh. And the Bible says that Nineveh is such a huge, giant, important, great city that it takes 3 days to visit the whole city. And so the first day Jonah gets there, he begins to shout out the message. He says, in 40 days, God's going to destroy Nineveh. And he's sharing this with everybody. And everybody around starts to hear it as he goes through the city. And everyone immediately believes it. They believe that God is going to do this. And they believe in Jonah's God. And so they believe this so strongly that they put on sackcloth, which is an itchy, scratchy, uncomfortable, yucky kind of cloth to be able to wear. It's you wouldn't want to wear it. But they choose to do that because it reminds them of their ickiness, their meanness. They're not living life the way God says to live it. And so it's a reminder to them of their need for God's love. But they also do something else. They also fast. Fasting is a giving up of something, and in this case, it's a giving up of food. And so while they're thinking of their itchy grossness and that they need God's love in their life and they need his forgiveness, while they're thinking of that with that itchy cloth, they're also not eating. And this helps them to think on it strongly. It helps them to not think of anything else except God. And so they're doing this. And it takes so long, so much time, that finally the king in his palace hears about it. The king of Nineveh, this great important nation. So the king of Nineveh hears about it. And he does the same thing. Because of God's message, God's words that Jonah is speaking, even the king is changed by it. And he sends out a decree, which is a ruling law that everyone has to follow, and even the king himself can't change it. It's that important. He sends out a decree that can't be changed, and he says, let everyone, man and beast, no longer eat anything. And let everyone, man and beast, which is a silly picture, wear sackcloth. Now, they're not really going to put on sackcloth on their cows or on their sheep, but it's a word picture to show how important we all need to think about God, is what the king is saying. So the king says nobody's going to eat anything and everyone's going to wear sackcloth until the Lord God that Jonah is talking about has compassion on us and he doesn't destroy us. So the whole entire city is doing this. Now, meanwhile, Jonah, God sees what is going on in Nineveh. And because God sees the hearts of the people have been changed, God does have compassion and he does not destroy the city. Now, meanwhile, Jonah, he's gone through the city, he's given God's message, and he goes outside of the city, and he sees that God is not destroying it, and he gets angry. He gets really mad, and he throws a fit, and he just has his little throwing fit right there outside of the city. And I'm changing the words a little bit, but this is in chapter 4, and this is where we pick up the main part of our story. Jonah basically looks at God and he says, I knew it. I knew you were going to forgive this people. I knew you weren't going to punish them. And I just knew that's what was going to happen. That's why I got a ticket. And I was going to go all the way to Nineveh because I knew, God, what you were going to do. Oh, I'm so angry right now. So angry. I wish I could just die. That's how angry he was. And God says, what right do you have to be angry? In other words, I gave you a message because I had a plan. And these are my people too. Who are you to be angry at my plan? But Jonah doesn't listen. Instead, he goes out. He's so mad. And he goes and he sits outside the city. Well, the sun is really hot where Nineveh is. It's a very, very hot, dry, sunny place. And even though Jonah's acting all angry and throwing his fit because God didn't do what Jonah thought God should do, God still loves Jonah and he has compassion on him. He has a soft heart for Jonah and he causes a vine. God causes a vine to grow up and it blooms and it sprouts and it gives shade to Jonah while he's sitting in the sun. Well, Jonah sees this vine. He's like, oh, this is nice. And he kind of gets in the shade. Oh, this isn't so bad to sit out here and wait. And he's still waiting to see now if I threw my fit, maybe now God will do what I thought he should do. So he's going to watch and he's going to wait to see what happens. Well, the shade is really, really nice for him. But God wants to teach Jonah. And so what happens is the vine grew up overnight. And overnight, the next night, a worm comes. And God causes this worm to chew on the vine just enough that the sun and everything causes the vine to die. And so it withers up and it dies. So it's no longer giving shade. Well, Jonah gets angry again. Oh, this is terrible. And because it's a hot, sunny, dry place, God causes a big, huge, hot wind to come across. And it's so hot and it's so terrible. Oh, my word. And Jonah, he feels like he's going to wither and die too. He feels faint and he's just, oh. And God again tells him, now that he has Jonah's attention, he says, Jonah, why do you have any right to be angry over this vine? And Jonah says, but I do have a right to be angry. I loved this vine and oh, it's gone. I should just die. Now, I'm kind of being a little bit silly in Jonah's wording, but I want to show you his heart. And that's why I wanted to show Jonah this way. Because what Jonah is saying is God, I see the face of these people are my picture for their meanness. So instead of looking at these people and seeing some people who have made some bad choices and they don't know any better, instead, their face is meanness to me and I don't think of them as being able to be kind. I don't think of them as just not knowing how to behave. Instead, their face becomes a picture of meanness. And so when Jonah looks at these people of Nineveh, that's now all he sees. But God reminds him and God says, but Jonah, this vine grew up and died overnight. You didn't make it grow. You didn't take care of it so it could grow strongly and healthy. You didn't do anything for this. And yet you care more about this vine, this plant, than you do about a people. And God tells him in Nineveh, there are over 120,000 people that God created, people that God loves and is trying to show them how to live the right way. God doesn't see a face of meanness when he looks at the people. God sees a people who don't know. They don't understand what their choices are doing, and they don't know God. And God wants to teach them and help them to see this. That's what God sees when he looks at people. But instead, Jonah, and sometimes us, we look at somebody who has been mean to us, and now their face is only mean when we look at them. That's all we can see. They could say, hey, good morning, and instead we see the mean thing they did, and so we don't hear their kind, loving words. We think that they can only be mean, and that's not how God sees people. Jonah's story to me today is so important because no matter what people might say, no matter what people might do to us, even if it's something mean, we cannot look at their face and only see that mean thing. Instead, what we should see is, you know what? Maybe they did a mean thing. Maybe they made a wrong choice, but maybe it's because they don't know. Maybe it's because they don't understand. So instead, let's show a loving God to them by loving them. Let's, like what Jonah chose to do, it was to be able to give God's message to the people. Let's do that with our life choices, with how we choose to act around other people. They might be mean to us, but instead of seeing mean when we look at their face, let's see a face of a person who might not know better or maybe feels bad about their choice, but we don't know that. And so we don't know what their heart is thinking or feeling. When we look at them, let's see them the way God sees them, a people who need the Lord, a people who love God, and maybe they don't know how to ask for forgiveness, or maybe they don't understand that their words hurt us. So let's not look at a face of a person and see the mean thing. Instead, let's look at the face of a person and see someone that God loves so much, he wants them to know him and understand him. So let's help them do that with our words and our actions and how we choose to love them even if they were mean. Let's see them the way God sees them. And you know what? We can't do that on our own because I'll be honest, my heart gets hurt and my heart thinks on that hurt. I need God's love in me to help me to see people through God's eyes. So what we need to do whenever we get hurt, pray and tell the Lord, I want to forgive this person. Help me to forgive them. Help me to love them and to see them the way you do. And you know what? It might happen right away or it might take a long time. But don't give up. Keep praying that. Keep trying. And God will help you to do that. And don't see people's faces for the meanness. See people's faces as someone who needs God and wants to know God, and we can help them do that. I love you all. I hope you have a great week this week, and I hope Jonah's story helps you like it helps me. There's so much in his story. I love it. So have a great rest of your week. Enjoy, and as always, you can reach me at PastorSarah@PerryNazarene.com. I'd love to know what you're thinking and to pray for you and to help you with any questions you might have. So have a great, blessed week.